I am delighted to see the number of people here that are here and to see many faces of friends as well as new people to get to know. My name is Wendy Craker, and I'm an instructor here in the Peace and Conflict Transformation Studies Department of Canadian Mennonite University. Our university is located on Treaty 1 territory. We drink Treaty 3 water, and we are on the traditional territory of the Anishinaabe peoples and the homeland of the Métis Nation. This university and the forks of the city of Winnipeg sits at the crossroads in the Anishinaabe, Métis, Cree, Dakota, OG, Cree nations. And by saying this, it's humbling, acknowledging that the work needed to create steps of reconciliation is only at its infancy. And perhaps appropriate after that to say, we are here to watch on the side of the road by Lia Tarachansky. Thank you so much for coming. So it's hosted actually by the class that I teach on Wednesday nights. It's a group of 18 women that meet to reflect on cultures of violence, cultures of peace. And if you can just wave, my great women of Wednesday nights, just wave. In addition to our hosting of you here tonight, we have sponsors, MCC Manitoba, Independent Jewish Voices Winnipeg, Peace Alliance Winnipeg, United Jewish People's Order, Conference of Manitoba and Northwest Ontario, the United Church of Canada, Canadian Palestinian Association of Manitoba, United Network for a Just Peace in Palestine and Israel, St. Paul's United Church, Morden, Manitoba. We will have the opportunity to watch the documentary, and then have an opportunity for conversation with the director. How often do you get that opportunity? This will be facilitated by Esther Reptison. She's the Ottawa Office Public Engagement Coordinator for MCC Canada. There are some costs to this, and a hat or some sort of item will be passed after the screening to collect some change to pay for Lia's travel. We might all be feeling somewhat fragile in the day after, the night before, a Big Brother down south. How do we do our peace building in the face of divisive issues? How do we continue to work on constructive dialogue for finding constructive ways forward in our quest to establish our identity in the context of mutual dignity offered to all? And I think that's part of Lia's challenge in her work that we will see tonight. So in the context and a circle of looking forward to embracing different ideas, approaches, questions, ways of life, in a context of peace building, a belief that transformation is possible, we offer up this time together. I'd like to introduce now Harold Schuster. He's with Independent Jewish Voices Winnipeg. I know him as the Brunswick Books guy, but he's here today with his IJV hat, and Harold will come forward to introduce the director. Harold.
Good evening, and thank you all very much for coming out. Lia was born in Kiev and since 1993 has lived in the West Bank settlement town of Ariel. She has a degree in biomedicine and is 2 months away from obtaining a master's degree in film studies from Raindance School of Film. She has worked as a reporter for the Real News Network on Israel-Palestine, and her work has also appeared on Al Jazeera, US Today, and 972 magazine. Her favorite color is pink. Her favorite food is seared tuna, but because tuna is on an endangered species list, she's now moved on to complicated salads. You'll always find cabbage in her fridge, she is Russian after all, coconut milk and hummus. Her best airline food was on Serbian Airlines. When she grows up, she wants to be a mother. Her secret indulgence would be a midnight snack of Russian black bread, goat cheese, and cranberries, eaten standing up over the kitchen sink. Please welcome Lia Tarachansky.
So that line of questioning was sprung up on me last minute, so I'm sorry. That's a little bit more about me than I wanted you all to know. But I really do owe quite a bit to Harold. This is really an incredible story. I met Harold just over a month ago in a conference in Saskatoon where I was showing the film. And he said, you know, it'd be great to have it in Winnipeg. And I thought, yeah, okay, someday, you know. And then like this. I have speaking engagements, tour, this is happening, all of you came. This wonderful community has come together. In the same conference, I had the incredible privilege of meeting also Joanna, and I don't know where you are, and Esther, who have been wonderful, and just such a ray of sunshine. And here in Winnipeg, it just arrived 24 hours ago, I already met two Davids. And I'm really grateful to them and to David Weller specifically for housing me. Thank you, David. Just wonderful people that I'm meeting here. I just wanted to say a couple of words about how this particular film came about so that it might help you a little bit in the process of watching it. I'm not used to speaking behind podiums, but I guess I should speak into a microphone. So I'm sorry if this comes off lectury. Please try not to fall asleep. It'll just be 4 minutes, I promise. But essentially, this film came about, I started filming it in 2009. And what was happening was I was working as a journalist in Washington, D.C., covering Obama's first election in 2008. And at that point, I had already thought of myself as a very liberal, open-minded Israeli, because I could admit to myself that, well, of course, everything is the fault of the Arabs. Okay, we did some things wrong, too. And then I discovered the Nakba, the events of 1948. And suddenly, all of the processes that have been happening in this place that I grew up in Israel-Palestine, all of the processes started to make sense, one contingent, continual sense. And so I thought to myself, if 1948 finally opened my eyes to what's happening, what I'm going to do, and this is what I was thinking as a journalist, what I'm going to do is I'm going to find the top experts in the field, I'm going to interview them, they're going to prove without a shadow of a doubt that much of what we learn about the origins of the conflict is mythology, I'm going to move back to Israel, I'm going to show that film to everyone, and all the Israelis will say, oh my God, I didn't know, and then the conflict would end, and everything would be great. I was younger and naive, but in a way I did do that because I ended up meeting those experts and historians, incredible people like Ilan Pape and Benny Morris and some traditional, this guy's always taking pictures of me when I talk. And next time I'm going to, here, you know what? So I ended up meeting all these experts in the field of 1948, Palestinian and Israeli historians. And I moved back to Israel in 2009, and I started editing this footage and going through these hours and hours and hours of interviews with historians. And as I was going through all this research, two things happened. First of all, I grew up in a house, I grew up in a family where most of our family was killed in the Holocaust or fighting the Nazis. And so we didn't have many family members, and the family members that did survive, at the very least my mother, drilled into my head that the most important tribute you can pay to that suffering is to really know what happened. Really, really know what happened. The details, the dates, who was alive, what was their name, where did they live. And so I took that kind of attitude about learning the details of this catastrophe, this mass displacement of two-thirds of the Palestinians. I took that same approach to the Nakba, and I started learning the specifics of the details, and I started talking to everybody around me about those details. To my high school teachers and my friends and the grocer across the street and my neighbors, everyone, did you know? Did you know that this city, this village was called something else 60 years ago? Did you know that the people who lived here are today refugees in Lebanon? Did you know that this street had a different name? Did you know that this building that is now, you know, a nightclub used to be a mosque? Did you know? And because, of course, we immigrated to Israel when I was six, my grandparents didn't do the Nakba, didn't fight in the Nakba. I never got this twisted kind of half-truth about what happened. I didn't get anything. I grew up in the Israeli education system. There was nothing, much in the same way that there is not much in the Canadian education system when it comes to indigenous civilizations, their legal system, their economy, how did they live, what were their conflicts, how did they actually live in this land. We just didn't think about it. We didn't think about them. They didn't exist in our consciousness. And what happened, as I was talking to people about 1948, is I found that instead of them going, oh my God, that's so crazy, I didn't know, let's go read up some books about the Nakba, what ended up happening was that I would approach the conversation kind of like I had a bucket of facts. But they would approach with their own bucket of facts. And so we would take these buckets, these baskets of facts, and we would pour little facts on each other. Did you know about 67? Did you know about 1929? Did you know about this massacre? Did you know about that massacre? Until we were just pouring buckets of facts on each other and showering each other with facts, and then suffocating, drowning in mountains and piles of facts, and there was no communication happening. We weren't talking to each other. We were talking at each other, and we were fighting and screaming, and I would leave the conversation calling them a Zionist, racist, colonialist, and they would leave the conversation calling me an anti-Zionist, self-hating Jew, and that would be the end of it. And it used to drive me crazy. And so this is no longer a film about what happened in 1948. Sorry. If you want to know, that film exists, and in fact multiple versions of that film exist, some created by Palestinian directors, some created by foreign directors, and if you want a thorough filmography about that, I'd be happy to share. This, instead, is a film about the distance between those two conversations, because what I had realized is that we weren't hearing each other because we were talking about completely different things. And I think that one of the biggest realizations for me as a communicator, as a journalist, as someone who thinks a lot about how to communicate, was I realized that for us as Israelis and as Jews, in the end of the day, we were talking about the Holocaust. In the end of the day, we were talking about terrorism. We were talking about the trauma of everything we had experienced and the fear that we had of Palestinians. And when Palestinians were talking, they were talking about the Nakba. They were talking about the expulsions, living in exile, the dispossessions, living under military occupation, being second-class citizens in their own homeland. We were talking about completely different things. And so instead I made a film about the distance between those two planets and what prevents us from hearing each other. I hope you will stick around afterwards because there will be a Q&A. And I hope you will enjoy the film. I also wanted to say a really quick thank you to Jace, who has figured all this audiovisual madness out. He's been on his feet as I've been panicking, so thank you very much, and maybe we can hit the lights.
My name is Esther Eptis, and I'm going to be facilitating the question and answer period. So I'm going to invite Lia to come and join me here at the microphone. And you can continue to write your questions on your sheets and or your cards, and then the volunteers will pick them up and bring them forward. I was one of the fortunate people who got to meet Lia at the end of September in Saskatchewan, and to see the film for the first time, and it's wonderful to have the opportunity to meet once again and to see the film a second time, because I learned so much. I learned so much more on this second round. I think one of the things that I noted on the first time was when you said you were already into your teens, perhaps, or maybe it was when you returned to Ariel, that you heard the Muslim call to prayer from the Palestinian village nearby. And I thought, how can this be? The village is right there. How can it be that many years before you hear? And then I was thinking about our own situation in Canada and how many centuries have we lived here on this land of Turtle Island before we have noticed the indigenous people who were here long before us settlers. So, and we talked about this a little bit earlier today about that connection. Anyway, while we're waiting for some questions to be delivered to me, I'm going to start. Lia, one of the things you said, it is to question is very Israeli. Can you say a little bit about that? What did you mean?
It's not for nothing that the expression three Jews, 16 opinions came about. I think that the social justice movement of 2011 in Israel, what was called the Israeli Summer, came shortly after the Arab Spring. It's no surprise that that happened. It was the biggest solidarity movement in Israel, kind of like an Israeli version of Occupy Wall Street, and we saw the biggest protests in the country's history. We saw 500,000 people on the streets of Tel Aviv in a country of 7 million. It's really quite incredible. And, night after night after night, there were more than 34 different tent cities around the country with hundreds of tents each. And night after night, there would be thousands of Israelis sitting and questioning and digesting and trying to understand the systems of oppression that exist in Israel. I think that one of the great benefits of the Israeli education system is that it teaches you how to think, and unfortunately about everything except for the conflict. And I think that as a result, the biggest element of the Israeli DNA becomes knowing what questions you cannot ask, because once you start asking these questions, the whole narrative starts to unravel. So I think that I was brought in a community that encouraged critical thinking, and I took that critical thinking to the conflict.
All right, here's the first question. What catalyzed Tikva into looking at what she had participated in?
That's a question for Tikva. So first of all, Tikva Honig Parnas, who is the first veteran I speak to in the film, she's since has written two really, really wonderful books, and I really recommend that you read them. The first is called Between the Lines. It's an anthology of a magazine she used to edit with Taufik Haddad, who is a Palestinian academic and journalist. And the magazine was called Between the Lines, and in 2003 they put together an anthology of the best essays. It's a wonderful, wonderful book. The introduction to the book alone is worth it. It's the best political economy analysis of the conflict I've ever read. And then the second book that she published after the film was created is a short history of the Israeli left, what happened to it, and where it went awry. And in that book, she describes her own process. So Tikva was a soldier in 1948. As you learn in the film, she participated in the ethnic cleansing of the 18 villages between Jerusalem and Tel Aviv, on the road between Jerusalem and Tel Aviv. And years later, she started working as a secretary for what became the Labor Party in Israel. And she was tasked with the documents, with archiving the documents. And through that work, she started to discover things that she didn't understand as a mere soldier fighting in that war. And over the course of the years, in the 60s, she became a member of Matzpen, which was the first non-Zionist Israeli group of activists that really, really questioned what was going on. And they were so clear about what they stood for that in June 1967, 5 days or 4 days after the occupation of the West Bank and Gaza, they published an editorial in Haaretz. The occupation of the West Bank, Gaza, the Golan Heights, and the Sinai Desert. They published an editorial in the Haaretz saying, we must immediately pull out of these occupied territories because if we stay there longer than is immediate, it will become an entrenched element of the Israeli military regime, and we will lose our own moral compass with this occupation. That's 4 days after the occupation started. So that was when she became, I would say, ideologically invested in conflict resolution. But it wasn't until the 90s that the story that she tells in the film actually happens, when she herself realizes the extent of her denial and ties it to 1948. So for her, as it is for me, I would say it's been a spiral of understanding and a spiral of connecting the breaking through the denial, the understanding of the denial intellectually, understanding of the conflict intellectually, understanding it emotionally, and then understanding it psychologically. And every time that you go through that spiral, you feel like you're going in circles, but you get deeper every time.
Are you more hopeful or less hopeful today about the possibility of bridging the two conversations you mentioned before the film? More hopeful or less hopeful?
The $64 million question. Do I have to? Okay, here's what I'll say. So I'm going to quote someone who spoke with me on the panel in Saskatoon. He's a Palestinian lawyer and the founder of Al-Haq, which is the International Law Center in Ramallah. And he was asked that question in Saskatoon, and maybe you remember the answer. But he was saying that it's very important to separate optimism from hope. Optimism is something that goes up and down based on events as they unfold and your understanding of history. And he said, am I optimistic? No, absolutely not. Every decade has gotten worse for the Palestinians than the decade before. And on the Israeli side, I would say every decade has led to more segregation and more entrenched denial than the decade before. But hope is something that's separate from optimism. For him, he said, and I believe this true, hope is has almost a faith-like spiritual value. It's not a feeling, it's an action. And I tend to think of hope as a verb. At the points where I really think like, shit, there's really nothing that I can do anymore. Points such as when President Donald Trump becomes the leader of America. That is exactly when you have to get up and do something and start that or continue that work, because hope is a verb. The second thing I would say, I would also like to quote a Palestinian friend of mine. Her name is Samah Sabawi, and those of you who lived in Ottawa perhaps know her. She's moved to Australia. Samah is an incredible, incredible human being and a poet, the daughter of a poet. And I remember, Samah was born in 1967 in Gaza. And amazingly, for those of you who speak Arabic, you know that Samah means forgiveness. So her father, while having his daughter born in the middle of the occupation of the Gaza Strip and the flood of refugees that came in that year, 1967, decided to call his daughter Forgiveness. And I remember in 2008, during Casled, which was the biggest at the time, biggest bombardment of Gaza that we've ever seen, I was already at that point at wit's end in terms of hope and optimism. And I said, Samah, I'm losing hope. I don't know what to do. And she says, in the most soft, loving voice that I'm sure those of you who know her to have, she said, Lia, every day that goes by that the Palestinians don't give up hope, you have no right to give it up. And that has been sort of the lighthouse in the ocean of darkness in my world, and I hope you can take it with you as well.
Here's a question that follows on what you said. What changes do you see with Donald Trump as U.S. president?
I think I'm the wrong person to answer that. What I will say is that we've had the government of Benjamin Netanyahu since 2009, and Benjamin Netanyahu has actually implemented most of the things that Trump has threatened the world that he would do. Netanyahu's government built a giant wall on the border with Egypt, a a wall that for the first time in human history segregated Africa from Asia. And largely the Palestinians build that wall. Netanyahu's government has introduced a series of terrifying repressive laws, loyalty laws, laws that criminalize certain kinds of thought, certain kinds of action, certain kinds of speech, laws that forbid critical films, critical artistic creations, laws that defund theaters. He's put into his cabinet politicians that describe themselves as fascists. The Minister of Justice is a woman who said that all Palestinians are legitimate targets of Israeli bombardment, especially women, because they give birth to terrorists. She's the Minister of Justice. The Minister of Culture is a woman who said that non-Jews are a cancer in the Israeli body. You know, we already have had for the last 7 years the kind of government that Trump has been threatening about, and it's been awful, it's been terrifying, but we have struggled through it, and we have seen some of the most exciting and beautiful resistances that have come as a result of that. So I don't know what's coming, but I do know that anything that speeds up the pullback of American imperialism outside of the United States is good in my books. And I have no doubt that if Hillary Clinton was elected, it would mean an immediate war in the Middle East, because she would have to prove to the world that she's as tough as she says she is. For those of us who live in the Middle East, I'm very grateful that she is not in power. I'm not happy he's in power, but that's something I keep in the front of my mind.
Can you talk about the rate of settlement building? Is it slowing down or speeding up?
I can't remember which of the Israeli politicians said it today, but it was someone in the cabinet that said the election of Donald Trump is the final nail in the Palestinian state's coffin. So I would say that since in the last 11 years, since the end of the Second Intifada in Israel, we've had the quietest years since the beginning of the conflict. 10 years of almost no terrorist attacks. 10 years of total quiet, near quiet acquiescence with Israeli expansionism, because of course Israel has assassinated and imprisoned almost all of the political leadership and criminalized most of the resistance to a level that using the Palestinian Authority has led to total repression of Palestinian nonviolent and also violent resistance. And so because of this quiet, The government has been taking advantage of the lack of public attention, because of course the media goes where the conflict is. Most of the international press has actually shut down their bureaus in Israel. And so we've seen this steady and growing encroachment of Israeli settlements in the West Bank, to the point where the plan of one of the main leaders of the settler right, Naftali Bennett, who's today the Minister of Economy, his plan is to annex the rest of the West Bank, give semi-autonomy to a few islands of Palestinian cities, such as Ramallah and Nablus, where there's too many Palestinians, give that to the Palestinian Authority, annex everything else, give citizenship to the few thousand of Palestinians left in the areas between cities, after you kick out as many of them as possible and urbanize the rest, and that will be the end of the conflict. They call it not conflict resolution, but conflict management, and that's a term that you hear a lot from Netanyahu, because he's essentially adopted the Naftali Bennett plan. In that plan, they're envisioning that Gaza will be handed over to Egypt, and President Sisi has made it very clear he'd be willing to do that. And so we're seeing now for the first time the unfolding of the plan for the resolution as presented by the right-wing government, which is basically a creation of Bantustans in the West Bank, the destruction of Palestinian resistance, getting rid of Gaza, giving it to Egypt, and then supposedly, according to their plan, there will be peace. And that, of course, meant speeding up of settlements. I don't know whose question that is, but does that answer it?
Okay. Is service in the Israeli army still required of young adults? And the follow-up is, has there been a greater refusal of mandatory military service by young adults since 2011?
Since 2011, I would say there's been a much greater politicization and a much greater cynicism that spread across young generation towards the government. That hasn't yet spread to the army. The Institute of Israeli Democracy, or the Israeli Democracy Institute rather, does a survey every year of the Israeli freedom of the press, the media, institutions, and so on. And every year they ask the population which institutions they have sort of respect and faith in. The Israeli army is still at the very top, because of course the Israeli army in Israel, much like the Egyptian army in Egypt, represents the people's force. It's seen as a depoliticized force, as a place where brotherhood and sisterhood triumphs over the divisions, very, very strong and very racist divisions we have amongst the Jewish community inside Israel. So, no, the rate of refusal of the army has not increased. Yes, in Israel we still have draft for women and men. Men serve 3 years in the Israeli army, women serve two. Almost all Israeli Jews serve in the army except for the religious. And after you do your three-year service, men then serve for 1 month in the reserve duty every year until they're pretty much before 50 or 60 years old, depending. And some women also volunteer for reserve duty.
What advice do you have for having a dialogue with Zionists?
So one thing that I realized as I was touring this film, and it was first, the film actually came out maybe I'll backtrack. So the Nakba law has been proposed in 2009, at a time when I was starting to make the film, and at a time where most Israelis didn't know anything about the Nakba. And then Netanyahu's government rises to power, and they propose as one of their first laws the Nakba law. And this was a proposition by the party of, maybe you remember her, Minister of Defense Avigdor Lieberman. And his party proposed this law, which would, at its original version, would say that any commemoration of 1948 as anything but a celebration of Israeli independence is a criminal offense punishable with 3 years in jail. The proposition of that law made, of course, the media have to explain to the population that from now on you can no longer talk about the Nakba. And then, of course, one of the anchors would say, well, wait a minute, what's the Nakba? And then, of course, the anchors would have to explain to the Israeli population this thing that we cannot talk about anymore, which is the Nakba, and the Nakba means this and this and this. And so inadvertently, the Nakba law made the word Nakba a word in Hebrew, and then suddenly we had a whole population going around saying, wait a minute, what? And so that made the film possible, because of course it was all this discussion about the Nakba as I was filming the film. And the more I was doing the film, the more I started to realize I'm actually going to have a platform in which to present this, because I wasn't sure at all of this. And in the end, the film premiered in the biggest theater we have in Israel for documentaries and was covered by the full gamut of the Israeli press, including, amazingly, the Settler TV Channel 7 gave us hardcore primetime airtime to talk about the film. And because I'm a settler, we ended up in this amazing conversation about practicalities of return and how it would be possible, not whether it should be possible, but how it would be possible to bring the refugees back. And in that process, then touring the film to all these different countries, I've started to realize that speaking across conflict is a skill. And so I started studying as a skill. I approached it as a journalist, and I've devised a whole spectrum of tactics. And now Independent Jewish Voices, which has actually put this screening on today, is helping me organize workshops across the country called Beyond Polarized Kvetching. If you don't know what kvetching is, it's Yiddish for, pointless complaining. And we actually practice these skills. How do you approach people who have created a self-constructed wall around their consciousness? From behind that wall, how do you dig a tunnel underneath the wall rather than banging on it, in order to invite them to come with you through that tunnel to the other side to then see the wall for the first time. And in the process of accumulating these skills and doing these workshops, I've realized that people self-educate. You cannot educate people. The best thing you can do is invite them to want to self-educate. And for me, in my own process, as someone who's come from a far-right Zionist background, then was essentially had that tunnel built for me, coming to the other side of the tunnel and realizing that there was a wall on the other side, that was made possible by a community of empathetic and patient, very, very patient, activists and anti-Zionists that knew that if they kept pushing, someday I will come around. And in the course of my touring, I ask every activist I meet, how did you come around? Every anti-Zionist I meet, how did you make the switch? And I've heard the full gamut of stories, most of them involving connection across conflicts, understanding the links between colonialisms. Most of these stories include meeting Palestinians and discovering Palestinian narratives for the first time. Many of these stories include meeting anti-Zionist Jews and realizing their humanity and our own. And all of these stories involve personal, emotional processes, personal emotional experiences, personal emotional interactions. In that entire time, I had never met anyone who told me, I used to be a hardcore Zionist, and then someone set me down, and with the right collage of statistics, they convinced me that I'm wrong. And yet, that is the vast majority of the tactics that we use in the activist community. We approach this wall of denial with a barrage of facts, a bucket of facts, and that's just not how communication works, in my opinion. In my opinion, it is not what you are saying, it's the meaning of what you are saying. And so I would love to expand on that, but I think that would take forever. What I think I will say is that behind every slogan, and as someone who, when I came to Canada, was still deeply racist and deeply entrenched in my own denial, I had later realized that I actually had a box of slogans at my feet that was placed there conveniently by the Israeli government and the media and the curriculum and my friends and my parents, who maybe didn't know, but they were building for me a little box of slogans. And whenever I was challenged on the conflict, what I would naturally do is pull into that box of slogans. Israel is the only democracy in the Middle East. Israel is the only gay-friendly country in the Middle East. All the Arabs are terrorists, and so on and so on. Behind every slogan, there is a whole world of fears and a whole world of values. And when I started approaching these slogans, not from the place of sort of ridicule and elitism, but from the place of compassion and trying to understand how a person got there, I would help the person through a series of questions and mirrors to get to the point where they realize behind the slogan that you're saying, behind the slogan I'm saying, there's a whole world of values. And in those values, we have common ground. Israel is the only democracy in the Middle East says to me that the value that the person cares for is democracy. That is the value I care for too. I hope someday Israel will be a democracy. And so when you get to that common ground, when you build that tunnel, when you build that bridge through which someone can feel safe to walk through, you can invite them into an honest and in-depth and personal conversation. It does take forever. It is an investment. It's a lot harder than just throwing a bunch of links at them and accusing them of being a racist. But I found that that has been a much more enriching process for me. I don't know if that answers your question, but that's all I got.
Okay, we just have a few more, and then we'll draw the evening to a close. Lia, boycott, divestment, sanctions, the BDS movement, is it having an effect?
Okay. Does everyone know what BDS stands for? Oh, I'll explain. Okay. In 2005, the biggest coalition of Palestinian civil society organizations sent out a call out, much in the same way as the anti-apartheid struggle in South Africa did. And they essentially asked the world community and activists to boycott, push for divestments and call on their government to sanction Israel in order to bring about a global pressure in order to end the occupation. They had three demands. Their demands were essentially the end of the occupation, equal rights for all the citizens of Israel, and the return of the Palestinian refugees. So the movement had been steadily growing for 10 years, I would say 9 years until 2014, steadily growing abroad, growing across campuses, high schools, churches, unions, had significant symbolic and also some financial successes. And then in 2014, in January, there were two major divestments by the Danish banks and a Dutch pension fund in the millions, divestments in the millions from the Israeli economy. And when those divestments happened in January 2014, suddenly the Israeli media discovered the boycott movement, as they call it in Hebrew. And for about a month, from morning to night, we had a flood of coverage in the financial press, the mainstream press, the televisions, the radios, the newspapers, the government, everybody. What is this boycott movement? Oh my God, what's happening? Oh, the anti-Semites have a new tactic. Oh my God, oh my God, oh my God. And the first question and the main question everybody was asking is it impacting our economy? And so the Ministry of Economy did an internal survey and they asked Israeli businesses to report whether they've had an impact as a result of political pressures. And 21% of Israeli businesses in February 2014 said that they had experienced an effect on their bottom line. That's 2 years ago. So what happened in the months since is the government approached the BDS in the same way that the government approaches everything, which is you hit it with a hammer until it dies. And so the government created a new office inside a ministry that has no transparency. It's this mysterious building in Jerusalem, and it's called the Prime Minister's Office. It's an enormous building, and it is rumored that is also where the headquarters of much of the activities of the Mossad are. And they essentially gutted a chunk of the Israeli Army Intelligence Unit and transported them there and assigned them with the task of finding out who is behind this boycott movement. And so you suddenly had a whole giant floor of a building of army intelligence officers sitting on Facebook and making a giant map of these terrorizing, boycotting 80-year-olds across Europe and North America and university students that were advocating for justice and peace in Israel-Palestine. Fast forward after the war of 2014, now we have three ministries in the government tasked with collecting intelligence on Israelis that support the boycott movement. There's been laws that have criminalized the boycott movement in Israel and essentially collaborating with international governments, especially Canada and the United States and England, collaborating with the intelligence agencies of those countries to share information on anyone who supports the boycott, divestment, and sanctions movement, and trying to criminalize the movement in those countries, as I'm sure you saw in Canada. Each one of these ministries has been budgeted hundreds of millions of shekels. So the biggest economic impact of the BDS movement has been at the hands of the Israeli government itself. And I think that's what stupid governments end up doing. And so I would say that the impact of the BDS has been enormous. I mean, it took decades for the boycott and solidarity movement in South Africa to make even the smallest impact. In 11 years, the BDS movement has had a massive impact on Israeli consciousness and on the Israeli economy. And maybe not to the level that people want to get to in order to actually end the conflict, but it's moving in massive strides, much faster than anyone could have predicted. And I would say that as an Israeli, it is now illegal for me to endorse the boycott, divestment, and sanctions movement. And I think that that is exactly why people like me must. And so if you're in doubt, I do endorse it. There's a whole number of us in Israel that endorse it. If you want to make connections with Israeli researchers who are documenting the corporations that profit from the occupation and from the conflict, and who you can find out how they're connected to your economy, come talk to me afterwards. Also, you can Google whoprofits.org. They have a wonderful website and database. And there's another organization called Boycott From Within, which is a loose coalition of Israelis who support and endorse the boycott, divestment, and sanctions movement.
Thank you, Lia. Two more. You mentioned the Holocaust and the connection with your own family. This question goes like this. Do any Jews think about what they might be, about that they might be duplicating the Holocaust against the Palestinians?
Do any Jews think? I don't know who asked this question, but I don't know how you think I can answer it. I don't know if any Jews think about that. I certainly don't. What the fascistic movement of the National Socialist Party of Germany did to the Jewish people is not similar to what Israeli colonialism is doing to Palestinians. The intention of the Nazis was to eliminate, to exterminate the Jews. It's not comparable to what's happening in Israel. There are definitely comparable elements of European fascism that go to the root of some of the movements that operated inside the umbrella of Zionism from the very beginning, to the point where, for example, the militia under Jabotinsky wore black shirts in honor of Mussolini's soldiers because they were so enamored with the fascist movement. So there's element of fascism in Israel. There's elements of, obviously, colonialism that are similar to North American colonialism, and the roots of that similarity are not random. South African apartheid leaders actually came to Canada and the United States in the early years of Dutch control over South Africa and learned how you are doing it, brought that system to South Africa, and Israelis have learned that system from South Africa and brought it to Israel. There's elements of apartheid in the striated tiered system of rights. So there's a number of things we can compare, but I don't compare the Holocaust. The only thing those two have in common, in my opinion, is that both involve Jews. But the link that I think is important is that Israel is a perfect example of what happens when collective trauma is unprocessed and is then allowed to run free and manifest itself on another people's. And I think that that's a lesson that is incredibly important that we need to learn, that we need to understand how to process our traumas, how to approach those traumas. And I think that what the Nazis have done to the Jews and what the European complacent governments, including Canada and the United States, have allowed to happen to the Jewish people, to the Roma people, to homosexuals and communists in Europe, is a crime on such a scale that I don't think even 70 years later we really understand it. I certainly don't. So the one lesson I will take away from this is that, you know, repression, discrimination, and racism against anyone is wrong. And the lesson that we should learn as Jews is never again for anyone.
All right, this is one last question, and I think we will draw our evening to a close. Lia, does religious faith have anything to do with what you do, with the conversations you are trying to have with the making of this film? That is Jewish faith. Are you a person of faith?
Okay, so, gosh, you guys are relentless. I got asked that question earlier today in the talk that I did at the Mennonite Central Committee where Esther and Joanna are. And I didn't exactly know how to answer it then.
You did a great job. Did you say the same thing?
For me as a Reconstructionist Jew, I draw a lot on the spiritual and anti-oppressive elements of the Jewish faith. There are two basic principles of Judaism that I hold as the most important. The first is the commandment, do unto others as you would have them do unto you. Not do not do unto others, but do unto others as you would have them do unto you. That's very important to me. Another one, of course, is the story of the Jewish liberation from slavery. But I would say even more than that, the concept of tikkun olam, the concept that when, you know, the earth was created, the creator, the process of the earth creation was so violent that it shattered, it created shards that have spread across the world. And our job as human beings is to try and put those shards together and fix them. So we enter this world trying to make it a little bit better than the way we found it. Those are three principles of Judaism that I hold as sacred and that I hold in my prayers when I do pray, but I don't see the conflict as a religious conflict. It's becoming more now with religious fundamentalists essentially taking the conflict over. But one basic element of the Jewish culture that is really, really central in my opinion is the concept of transformation. How do you take something broken and you transform it? And I got this incredible present from Esther and Joanna at the end of the talk this afternoon. They gave me this pendant, this necklace, and it has on it a dove. And it was made by artists in Cambodia. And it says in English and in Cambodian, it says peace. And it's made out of, I don't know if you can see it, it's made out of landmines that were left behind, bombs, cluster bombs that were left behind in Cambodia, and they transformed it into this beautiful pendant that I hope I won't lose. And it's really a really beautiful, physical, concrete reminder I can hold in my hands and remember that all destruction can be transformed into life.
Wendy's going to come up and do the final closing, but I would just like to say thank you to all of you for your engagement, for your excellent questions, and thank you to Lia for your compassion, your creativity, and your incredible courage. Thank you.
Thank you, Esther, for guiding us during the Q&A. Lia, that's quite the stamina that you have had this evening. Thank you so much. As you folks are filing out, please note that there are two tables to take a look at. Independent Jewish Voices has an opportunity for you to grab a postcard that if you are concerned about this issue of Palestinian land, relationship with settlers, talk with Harold about this postcard. If you are thinking about Friday, November 11th, you may want to think of purchasing MCC to Remember is to Work for Peace. Options for you at that back table. I think it's a rare opportunity to see someone's voyage and change of heart, ears, eyes, as we have had the opportunity tonight. Thank you. That's been a privilege to journey along with you. You challenged us with your story of what we read in the media, the kind of ties that we, our government, we as peoples have to Israel. But you've also reminded us as Canadians of our own story and history and things that we have not noticed within our own country. And you've been able to do that in a way where we've had to say yes. We have seen you work on your story, and you have challenged us to work on our own story, and perhaps together we support each other's stories and journeys, and I think this has been a sacred moment to have that kind of conversation and those pushes that I think all of us need. So we have seen modeled here today, how does one handle difficult conversations? And they're happening all around us. This is a global issue for us that's not going to get any easier. So I think one thing to take home is just holding someone's story, but also thinking what our own stories and issues that we need to be finding ways to talk about. And as we here move towards Friday, our day of remembrance, what are the ways that we can work towards peace? Thank you also to all of you for coming this evening. We're thankful for you taking the time to do that, and hope that it leaves a mark on your story as well. So thank you. Safety as you go home.